ऑयस्टर विच इज ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बाय यूथ, ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बाय यूथ फॉर सोशल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन एंड एनवायरमेंटल रिकूप एंड IQAC निजाम कॉलेज उस्मानिया यूनिवर्सिटी. ह्यूमन राइट्स, human rights are not a privilege conferred by government, they are every human being's entitlement by virtue of his humanity, said by none other than Mother Teresa, the awardee of national Nobel Peace Prize for 1979. Moving on, I would like to invite Ms. Amrita Varshini and Dr. P. Himabindu Garu, coordinator for IQAC Nizam College, to give a brief introduction.
Good morning, everyone. I am Amrita Varshini, Joint Secretary of OYSTER, governing body of Nizam College. I hope everyone is safe and healthy during this pandemic. So today I'll give a brief information about one of the organizers of this great program, OYSTER. So OYSTER stands for Organization by Youth for Social Transformation and Environmental Recoup. It is a social responsibility-based registered non-governmental organization founded in the year 2009. It is the dream of a group of youngsters just like you and me who wish to mobilize the unseen efforts and strength of many citizens towards the community development and with the vision of youth empowerment for social transformation. And OYSTER's mission is not only to empower the youth, the future, who is the future of the country, but to also inculcate individual responsibility and sensitizing people to act on social issues and contribute their mite to the society. So it was founded by a group of committed youngsters to improve the living conditions of poor and marginalized communities and enable to live them with self-respect and dignity. With the inception, OYSTER is making sincere efforts towards realizing its aims. We ourselves feel that what we're doing is just a drop in the ocean. But if the drop was not in the ocean, I think the ocean would be less because of that missing drop. This was said by Mother Teresa. So now there's a question rises, like, why OYSTER? So the world today is a much developed place with all the comforts, just a snap away from man. We have seen much more than what our primates would have even visualized even in their wildest dreams. Yet there is much more to be seen, heard, felt, and created. It's not just the ever-advancing technological development. We intend to focus on man, on humans, on ourselves, and our not-so-privileged counterparts who live among us in this very society of ours, right next to us. We all have a heart, and that is what it takes us to keep all alive. We forget that heart is also capable of showing compassion. We gladly part with merely a few coins when our generosity gets better of us. I think it's high time we ponder over the fact, is that all it takes to make a difference, to bring about change? Is that all we as humans are capable of? If we actually think, the answer would be no. Many scholars have despaired over the apathy of men towards ills in our society. But we at OYSTER feel that every single person's contribution is the need of for building a better society. Truly, you know, we survive on the single motto, each and every person can contribute to his or her society. It is a must for each and every individual to take up the responsibility of protecting his or her own society. At OYSTER, we believe that it is the responsibility of everyone to come out of his complex, self-centered world and play his part in making the society a better place to live in. OYSTER has evolved to direct its sincere and genuine efforts to sensitize the citizens of our civil society and the elected representatives to work towards effecting a positive change in the society. At OYSTER, we are dedicated to cause of awakening social responsibility, of political awareness among citizens and establish social harmony, peace and justice. It is a platform to bring together all the drops in the mainstream under the rubric of social responsibility and social activism and to canalize it through the society with all due diligence and make it better in all possible ways. OYSTER, through its programs and networking with other organizations and institutions organizes perspective building activities, carries out campaigns, and makes people realize their role in the community development and the positive change they are capable of bringing about with their active involvement, even if it is in a small way. So that is about OYSTER. Thank you so much.
I would like to invite Simavindu ma'am, please introduce yourself and IPS. Simavindu ma'am.
Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome on behalf of Nizam College and Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Nizam College. So we at Nizam College, we do monitor the quality of the college and also do organize several programs as ordered by the UGC and also the government. And also we make sure that all kinds of quality measures are being maintained in this institution for the well-being and benefit of many of the students and all our stakeholders. So I do welcome everyone to this program, two-day national webinar on human rights, which is being organized by OYSTER, which is Organization by Youth for Social Transformation and Environmental Recoup, and jointly organized by IQSC Nizam College. So I do welcome today Srimati Jyotika Kalra Garu, Honorable Member of the National Human Rights Commission, New Delhi. Madam, namaste and welcome to our program. I also welcome Sri Justice G. Chandraya Garu, Member of Chairman TSHRC, Sri Gorepati Madhavrao Garu, President of TSHRF Hyderabad, and also our beloved Principal, Sri Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathod Garu, who is principal of Nizam College and also Dean Education, Osmania University. A very warm welcome to this two-day national webinar on behalf of OYSTER and also IQAC. So today on this occasion of Human Rights Day, which we are observing, Human Rights Day observed every year on 10th December actually, but for the convenience sake, this is Human Rights Week and we are doing today national webinar 11th and 12th. So the United Nations General Assembly adopted in 1948, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is a milestone document that proclaims the rights which everyone is entitled to as a human being, regardless of race, color, religion, gender, language, political, other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. And this document is available more than 500 languages, and it is the most translated document in the world. Every year, we have a special theme for Human Rights Day celebration. And last year, it was Civil Human Rights Front organized a rally in Hong Kong on the Sunday, December 8th to mark the Human Rights Day 2 days away. And it was estimated that 800,000 people took part in this. Also, the march started from Victoria Park in Causeway Bay and was the biggest of its kind since the march in mid-August as part of 2019-20 Hong Kong protests. This year, the theme for 2020 is Recover Better, Stand Up for Human Rights. So this also is being maintained as part of the innocent man who was executed by the US government on this day. So human rights must be at the center of the post-COVID-19 world. So the current pandemic, which has started in the beginning of this year. So actually it started in 2019, but it came into prominence and it has also spread a lot in the year 2020. And it is also taking over the entire world even now. So it has not stopped. So human rights must be at the center of the post-COVID-19 world. And this is our current theme for this year. And we have to look into the end of discrimination of any kind and address the inequalities, encourage participation and solidarity, and promote sustainable development. As you know, the COVID-19 pandemic has taken so many lives, taken away so many jobs, poverty has increased, and people have become restless, peaceless, and also there are so many health problems that have been arising, even psychological disturbances that have been arising with the pandemic. And also post-COVID, we have to check for all these things and look into the better world, better society. So hope this webinar would give an insight into how human rights can be the center of the post-COVID-19 world, and also what part we can take for the betterment of this society. I welcome you again, and I also thank Oyster for giving me this opportunity. Over to Oyster Sharath.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now I invite Dr. Priya, ma'am. Please introduce our special today's special guest, ma'am Jyoti Karlagaru. Ma'am, over to you. Yeah, ma'am.
Hello, good morning, madam.
Good morning, one and all. Thank you, Amrita Varshini, for a good beginning of this program, and thanks to Dr. Hima Bindu Garu for opening up this program. So it's a very proud moment for me indeed to introduce Ms. Jyotika Karla, who is a member of National Human Rights Commission, and Madam took this charge in April 2017. Before joining commission, she was a practicing advocate and advocate on record with the Honorable Supreme Court of India. She did her Bachelor of Commerce from Delhi University and Bachelor of Law from Campus Law Center, Delhi University. Her Master of Law is from Kurukshetra University. She has filed many public interest litigations. Significant among them are opening up a channel for females to practice as a makeup artist in a cine industry after 60 years of independence, raising the issue of non-recruitment of women in arms that resulted in opening of opportunities for women in territorial army, etc. She has conducted many awareness and gender sensitization programs with schools, colleges, universities, government and non-governmental organizations. She was a member of many sexual harassment committees and has dealt with many sexual harassment complaints. After being appointed as member of National Human Rights Commission, she has been dealing with subjects like women, children, LGBTI, trafficking, reproductive rights, etc. Under her leadership, many workshops have been conducted in the commission as well as in different parts of the country relating to protection of children from sexual harass offenses, juvenile justice, restorative justice, sexual harassment at workplace, gender equity, and economic development, etc. There are many in the list, but restricted for few of them. She has been honored by Supreme Court of India for her 3 books. She was given the award of Outstanding Women in 2014 by National Commission for Women. Applause for Madam for this award, Madam. She was an expert committee of NCW and deliberated on drafts of women-related laws. She was appointed amicus curiae in important matters, some of them concerning violation of women's rights. She was on the panel of Supreme Court Legal Services Committee. A passionate activist, she has been associated with many NGOs. As a representative of this organization, Ms. Karla has attended international conferences at Istanbul, Manchester, and United Nations headquarters, New York. She has deliberated on many rights of women which included surrogacy, female feticide, witch haunting, etc. She has worked on rights of domestic workers, workers in Gulf, Dalit entry in temples, victims of religious fundamentalism. She has presented many papers in the country and few abroad. Her sole motive is to spread the ideas and in furtherance of some reach out to as many people as possible. Her articles mainly on the subject of women and law have been published in various magazines and newspapers. In the past, she has enjoyed imparting knowledge as part-time lecturer in the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi and IP College, Delhi University. Madam has many pages of CV, but Madam, it's a proud privilege that I got an opportunity to introduce you, ma'am. Over to Sharath and Madam G.
Now, I would like to invite our special guest, Sri Jyotika Garla, Honorable Member, NHRC New Delhi, to enlighten us.
Yeah, thank you, Priya. And thanks to the Nizam College and Oyster for having invited me and given me this opportunity. I would also like to thank my brother, Justice Chandraya, Chairman, Telangana Human Rights Commission, I think because of whom I am here with you. So I'll not get myself involved into formalities and straight away come to the subject, like how are the human rights violated, how to protect, strengthen the human rights through Human Rights Commission. And I would start by saying that protection of human rights is a struggle to make rights a reality for all. So Universal Declaration of Human Rights was proclaimed by the United Nations General Assembly in Paris on 10th of December 1948 as a common standard of achievements for all people and all nations. The preamble, I'll take two paragraphs from the preamble of Universal Declaration. The preamble says that the recognition of inherent dignity and equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family is the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. And the other para, which I think is very important, is the para with regard to rule of law. And this para says that it is essential if man is not to be compelled to have recourse as a last resort to rebellion against tyranny and oppression, the human rights should be protected by the rule of law. I mean, the rule of law is a recourse for protection of human rights. And if it is not effective, if it is not being approached, if it is not capable of ensuring the human rights, then the people do not have any other option but to resort to rebellion against the tyranny. And I would only take up first article of this Universal Declaration, which I think covers the entire gamut of human rights. And this article, the Article 1, says that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. This Article 1 has a special significance for India, because Hansa Mehta of India contributed a lot for at the time of drafting of this article. She was a Indian delegate to UN Commission on Human Rights from 1947 to 1948. And I will quote Antonio Guterres about Hansa Mehta, and I quote, "Hansa Mehta of India, for example, without whom we would likely to be speaking of the Universal Declaration of Rights." Hansa Mehta is widely credited with making a significant Article 1 of UDHR by replacing the phrase "all men are born free and equal" with "all human beings are born free and equal." So if Hansa Mehta would not have been there, we would have been discussing about the human rights of all men rather than all human beings. So this declaration was adopted before India adopted its constitution, so almost a year before, and we can see that many of the articles of this declaration have found place in the fundamental rights of our constitution, chapter 3 of the constitution, and some of them are there in the directive principle of state policy, chapter 4 of the constitution. So I am of the view that once this equality and dignity of all human beings is ensured, then this struggle would come to an end. That struggle to make reality rights a reality for all will continue till we ensure that equality and dignity is ensured to the all human beings. Human rights is a negative right, and it is being agitated only when it is violated. It is presumed that being human, everybody has those human rights. So human right violation is certainly because of the action or non-action by the public servant. It, because the act is protection of human rights. It is not rights, but protection. That means rights are ensured, but when the public servants, it's basically against the public servants. The public servants are held responsible for action or non-action on their part. The protection of human rights becomes a responsibility on the national and state human rights commissions or human rights institutions. Some of the examples of human rights violations is, as everybody knows, like misgovernance, like vacant positions of doctors in the hospitals, and difficulty or problem in getting the birth register or the death register, getting a BPL card, non-payment of wages to the Anganwadi workers, to the ASHA workers, socio-cultural practices like witch hunting, devdasi, and environmental issues like presence of arsenic or fluorosis in the underground water, medical negligence, police atrocities, custodial torture, death in prison. These are some of the examples. I am not going into the details of the example because I presume the participants are aware of what are the issues of violation of human rights. But the question is that what are the challenges to the protection of human rights? I mean, violation of human rights is there. But what are the factors, you know, apart from the human rights institutions, what are the factors which perpetuate this violation further? So the first challenge can be the challenge of poverty. Because of poverty, there are people are defecating in open. Because of poverty, there is a practice of manual squinging, the practice of child labor, and the practice of child marriage. The reason being at the core is poverty. The women being considered as a weaker sex is another challenge, because of which there are sexual violence against the women, there are domestic violences against the women, there is discrimination against the women, and gender stereotype. So, as I said, the challenge of poverty can be overcome when we have universal employment guarantee, or everybody has sufficient money at his disposal for taking care of himself and his family. And women as a weaker sex, we need to empower, and we need to see that each and every woman is capable of taking this decision, has economic security. Similarly, you know, there are challenges of inequalities, the economic inequalities, religious majority, religious minorities, linguistic minorities, ethnic, racial, gender. And this majoritarian culture prevails, and because of which because of that majoritarian culture, that majority population thinks that that population is entitled to primacy in the society, and they have the right to make decisions that affect the society. So this majoritarian culture has to go, and the groups at the risk or distress, like HIV or AIDS victim, homosexuals, transgenders, they all need a mainstreaming. We have Supreme Court judgment, we have laws on that aspect, but still the ultimate rights become the reality when they are mainstreamed, when they are working with us, when they are there at the workplaces, when there are marriages, and when we participate in those marriages, we include them in our systems, in our this ecosystem. lack of education is also one of the major challenge why the human rights are being infringed. People are not in a position to access to the information. They are not in a position to access to the resources meant for them. So it is, I think we have a fundamental right to education, but still majority of our population who are not children are adults and they are uneducated. So apart from the fundamental right of quality education for all, we must also as a nation aspire to make all our adults or all adults also as primarily educated or literate. I think that would also help in overcoming the human rights violations. The terrorism is also one of the challenges, and we can see this in the Union Territory of Kashmir. And this is something which is a very grave assault on human rights, and the struggle against terrorism is being exploited in some parts of the world to abuse human rights. And the challenge of rule of law, the most important challenge, because we see that there are violation of human rights, but that is not the problem. The problem comes when there is a poor investigation, when there are poor conviction, when there is a poor conviction rate, and when there is a poor observation of the procedural safeguards. So the history of personal liberty is largely the history of insistence on observation of procedural safeguards. So in most of these human rights violations, poor and marginalized are pitched against the strong and powerful state. These victims can't withstand or the all-powerful state. There comes the role of human rights institutions like NHRCs and SHRCs. And these institutions stand by the sides of these poor and marginalized section of the society and ask and question the state about their role in violation of these fundamental rights, about their negligence, about their omissions, why the human rights have been violated, why are they not getting what is entitled to them. And I conclude by Antonio Guterres' quote again, and I quote, "Lasting peace and inclusive, sustainable development can never be achieved without full respect for human rights. On this anniversary, let us not only reflect on the enduring importance of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, let us also speak out and stand up for human rights everywhere." So thank you very much. And I conclude by saying that human rights, each one of us have to think for it from our hearts. It cannot be taught in the classrooms or in the four walls of the schools and colleges. Each one of us has to have that feeling of brotherhood again for all the human beings. And with this, thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your
thank you for enlightening us. Your words, "All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights." We are very much enlightened by your precious words. Now, I call upon Karunya to introduce our guest of honor, Professor L.B. Lakshmikant, Principal Nizam College.
Good morning, everyone. To paraphrase Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathore Garu, Principal of Nizam College. Today's guest is associated with Department of Physical Education, Usmania University since 1997. He has organized several national and international conferences and workshops like International Workshop and Recent Trends in Physical Education in June 2016, and International Conference on Physical Education, Fitness, Sports Science in August 2017. He has guided several MPhil and PhD research scholars. Apart from several achievements as a sports player, he has vast experience as a coach and team manager. Professor Rathore Garu has more than 70 publications to his credit. He is a member of professional bodies and commitments like All India Inter-University Athletic Meet, life member of Sports Psychology Association. He was president of Telangana Physical Education Teachers Association. He is a member of Academic Senate OU since 2012. He has visited several countries like China, UK, Thailand, Turkey, France, Vietnam, Iran, Germany, and many more. So please help me in welcoming the exceptionally courageous and skillful person, Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathore Garu. Thank you.
I welcome Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathore Garu to speak a few words. Please, sir, enlighten the virtual gathering.
Sir, will join within soon.
Has some technical issues. So we join by end of the
day. Yes, ma'am. We can proceed with the Chandraya sir video. Please introduce Mr. Justice Chandraya Garu. Ms. Sheba, please introduce sir Chandraya sir.
Yes. Now, I would like to introduce our next guest of honor, Justice G. Chandraya Garu, who is presently working as the Honorable Chairperson of Telangana State Human Rights Commission. Sir completed his LLB, MA, Political Science, and LLM from Usmania University, Hyderabad, and worked as a former High Court judge till 2016. His service towards society to eradicate social imbalances is remarkable. Though he is unable to attend the meeting right now due to his busy schedule, he has recorded the session for us. So let us enlighten ourselves through his words.
To deny people their human rights is to challenge their very humanity, said by Nelson Mandela. With this, we move on to the video. I guess there is some technical problem. I'll be briefing you all about our fundamental rights in India. There are 7 fundamental rights in India. First one, right to equality, right to freedom, right against exploitation, right to freedom to religion, cultural and educational rights, rights to constitutional remedies. These were the 7 fundamental rights of our country. The audio is not audible. Let me brief you all about right to equality. The right to equality is an important right provided in Article 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18 of the Constitution. It is the principal foundation of all other rights and liberties and guarantees. Equality before the law. Article 14 of the Constitution guarantees that all people shall be equally protected by the law of our country. It means the state will treat people in the same circumstances alike. Now I would like to start the video. Unless there are some technical problems, please look into that. I'll be proceeding with the briefing about right to equality. Social equality and equal access to public areas. Article 15 of the Constitution states that no citizen of India shall be discriminated on the basis of religion, race, caste, sex, and sexual orientation, gender or gender identity, and or place of birth. Every person shall have equal access to public places like public parks, museums, wells, etc. Now, moving on, I would like to call Ms. Akshita Reddy to briefly introduce about our guest of honor, Sri Gorepati Madhava Rao, President TSHRF Hyderabad. Over to Akshita Reddy.
Okay, thank you, Srinijan. And now I would like to introduce our guest of honor, Mr. Gorepati Madhava Rao Garu. Mr. Gorepati Madhava Rao Garu was graduated in law from Usmania University in 1982 and has been practicing since 1983 in courts of Nizamabad. Associated with human rights movements since 1985. And in the same year, he was elected as the Joint Secretary of APCLC. This association lasted till 1998. And then under the leadership of Dr. Bal Gopal Garu, they left APCLC and founded the Human Rights Forum, HRF. And now Mr. Gorepati Madhava Rao Garu is the president of Telangana unit of HRF since 2017. For the first time in India, filed the cases claiming compensation in lower courts in fake encounter cases and won. Mr. Gorepati Madhava Rao Garu also wrote a book on labor laws, rendered into Telugu, D. Kosambi's exasperating essay, and also contributes articles of human rights now and then. And now I would like to hear a few words from Mr. Gorepati Madhava Rao Garu. Thank you.
Thank you for the organizers for inviting me and the Human Rights Forum takes it as an opportunity on this occasion of International Human Rights Day to ponder over the situation of human rights whether these human rights are being honored and respected in the way the UNDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, wanted the states to be. 1948, December 10th, was the day on which the General Assembly of the United Nations adopted this UDHR. So all the participating states, that is the countries, took oath that they will see that the letter and the spirit of the UDHR reflects in their municipal laws in the sense the country's laws, that is either constitution or in the statutes made by the legislatures. So now we have to see whether the UDHR is being respected in its spirit also, in addition to the letter. So let me come to you with Article 55 of the, there are 30 articles in the UDHR, and most of the articles also find place in our constitution or in our statutes, that is criminal law. The Article 5 of the UDHR says there should be no torture. But you hear a lot of news that our police stations have become centers of torture throughout the country. So taking this situation into account, the Supreme Court also ruled recently that all police stations should be equipped with CCTVs so that whatever torture or inhuman treatment meted out to the accused persons or the persons who are suspected of committing some crimes, how they are treated in the police station, so that the CCTV footage can be used tomorrow to see whether any inhuman treatment is given to the inmates. In this regard, I would like to bring to your notice that this CCTV footage may become inadequate also tomorrow. So that's why Law Commission long back recommended to introduce, to enact a provision into the Indian Evidence Act to have to draw a presumption that whenever a suspect is produced before the court or comes out to the police station, and if any injuries are found on his body, it shall be presumed. The word, the recommended word is, the court shall presume that the prisoner, that is the suspect, is subjected to torture in the police station. But that provision is still kept in cold storage by the parliament. It has not taken up, and it is not enacted into Evidence Act. Had it been enacted into Evidence Act, the country could have avoided a lot of police torture and also custodial violence and custodial deaths. So it is urgent need of the hour to see that the provision recommended by the Law Commission is removed from the, is taken out from the cold storage, and it is enacted into Indian Evidence Act. See here, our just now I heard one of the organizers saying about the equality before law and equal protection of laws. The provision in UDHR is couched in such a language that it is a positive language, but the Indian Constitution in Article 14 used a negative language, that is, the state shall not discriminate. That is, so what it conveys, it conveys that the state once discriminated against the people and it denied equality before law. That was the feudal states or Rajadharma, when Rajadharma was the order of the day, or the when the states, feudal states, followed the Rajadharma. This Rajadharma clearly stated that the state shall protect the Chaturvarna system. And Chaturvarna system, you know, is based on discrimination. Discrimination in respect of not only one caste or other, But discrimination is mainly against the Sudras and Panchamas, that is, who are not within the Chaturvarna system. That is Parayas, that is, scheduled castes people and scheduled tribes people who were not within the Shudra community. They are called Panchamas or Avarnas, who have no Varna. So these are discriminated against by the state deliberately. And the Manudharmas or the Mahabharata or Kautilya's Ardhashastra, they clearly state that this is the Rajadharma, and Rajadharma has to see that there should not be any pollution between the or among the Varnas. So Varna has to be protected as it is. Varna itself is based on discrimination. And when this discrimination is there, state shall uphold this discrimination. Taking this account into the state, taking this fact and the history into account, what our Constitutional Assembly wrote in Article 14 is the state shall not discriminate equality, and it shall not deny equality of the protection of laws. So protection of laws was also in the previous history was confined to some Agravarna people, and lower Varna people who were denied access to the justice and access to the laws also. So that is why we have, when we understand this Article 14, why it was couched in such a negative language, we have to see the Indian history and the specific Indian history that was that was there, and how it discriminated against the people, and how the Indian state was directed by its shastras or its statecraft theories that it should discriminate, and equality should not be granted to all the people as of right. Now, one of the articles, articles 9 and 11 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, if read together, what we understand is there should be a presumption of innocence till the guilt is proved by a competent court and in a trial held in open court and impartial court. So these are the adjectives used. The court should be open, the trial should be open, and the judge should be impartial. And his guilt is to be proved, till guilt is proved beyond reasonable doubt, he is presumed to be innocent. This is the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence to which Indian government, while signing the UDHR, committed to observe this principle in letter and spirit in Indian statutes. But see, the section 44 of the UAPA, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, what it says is, you can hold an in-camera trial. You can withhold the names, disclosure of the names of the witnesses to the accused. So how do you protect yourself? How do you protect yourself that you are an innocent? How do you prove that you are an innocent? How can you cross-examine the witnesses unless you know all about the witnesses? When you cannot know the everything about the witness, your cross-examination cannot be effective. And when you hold in-camera trial, when the people have no access to witness the trial, anything can happen. Anything in the sense, not following or observing the statute in respect of trials can happen. Whether it happened, we do not know, but it can happen. So to prevent this from being happening, what the UDHR said is trial should be open and impartial judge, and every opportunity should be given to the person facing a trial, criminal trial, to prove himself to be innocent. That when Unlawful Activities Prevention Act is there, when it is denying everything that is that we feel sacrosanct, how can we say that this is a fair law? So it is most unfair law. And even Supreme Court said, while interpreting TADA provisions, that is Terrorist and Disruptive Activities Act provisions, that most of the provisions, most of the cases, the provisions are used to see that the person who is accused of some crime is not, does not get bail. That is, to deny bail, these provisions are indiscriminately used. So even now, we are seeing that a lot of tribal people in Khammam district are facing charges, are facing the accusations under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Even the dissent, if any, a small form of dissent is curtailed by invoking the provisions of Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Say, for example, I put two instances to your notice. V.S. Krishna is the coordination committee member of Human Rights Forum, and he is stationed at Vizag, Visakhapatnam. He is involved in two EOPA cases, one at Munchinpet police station and the other at Pidiguralla police station of Guntur. What is the accusation against him? So he was helping the Vakapalli people, Vakapalli, you know, Vakapalli women for the last 14 years have been fighting for justice as they were raped by security forces. So what he said is against Krishna, that he is helping the people to gain courage to give evidence against the police officers in the court. This is the bounden duty of any citizen of India to see that justice is rendered. So what Krishna is doing is, he is helping the scheduled tribe of women to come to the court and depose against the accused persons, police officers. It is not a crime. It is the duty. So your duty is also termed as the crime by the police. And three more members of the Human Rights Forum in Adilabad district, Atram Bhujangarao, Atram Suguna, Kanaka Venkateswarlu, these people are also being involved in Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. And their crime is to help the tribal people to assert their rights. So it is the bounden duty of the Indian citizen to see that constitutional rights are enjoyed by all the people, by all the people who are for whom these rights are given. But if you say this is your right and you can enjoy it, that itself is becoming a crime in India in the present situation. Even in Delhi also, we see whoever participated in the Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act struggle, they are being booked under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act to see that they do not get bail. And they will be incarcerated for longer periods in jails. So this is not in consonance with the UDHR. So UDHR, that is Universal Declaration of Human Rights, is being respected, with given a scant respect so far as this aspect is concerned. And now I would like to bring to your notice another aspect of the UDHR. That is, UDHR openly declares that right to privacy is fundamental to any individual, and the state should not tinker with it. But what is happening in India? Say, on August 24th, 2017, the Supreme Court unanimously, 9-judge bench, this 9-judge bench announces that right to privacy is fundamental to an individual. It is not limited to a citizen, but it is individual. So when this right is fundamental to the individual, when we say fundamental, the state shall, that is the government, should see that this right is enjoyed by the people without any restrictions from any quarter. That is the meaning of fundamental. That is, individuals' rights should be protected by the state. It should not tinker with that right. It should not restrict that right from being enjoyed by the people. That is what is meant by fundamental. But on December 20, 2018, the Home Secretary issues an executive instruction authorizing 10 intelligence organizations, 10 intelligence organizations to intercept, to inspect, to check your computer system. Computer system by default means, and it includes your smartphone also. So what the authorities or the intelligence agencies can do is, it can intercept or it can check your computer system, that is by your smartphone, to see any objectionable material is stored. When any objectionable material is generated, any objectionable material is transmitted. If you put a password to your phone and it cannot be opened by any intelligence officer, and if he directs you to open it, and if you resist or decline, then you can be punished with an imprisonment for 7 years. So this is the stringent law that is there in the Information Technology Act. And using those provisions, the Home Secretary gave 10 intelligence agencies to intercept your phone or computer system at any time. So this is the way the government is honoring the UDHR and the Supreme Court's judgment on right to privacy. And there is another provision in the UDHR where you can get information from any quarter beyond the borders of a state in the self's country. When beyond the borders, you can get the information, and when this information technology was not there in 1948, that provision was brought into effect in the UDHR. So now, if you want to get information or you want to get some research done using your information technology and using your phone, using your computer system with the help of internet, you are denied that opportunity for the Kashmiris. So Kashmiri student cannot make an effective research into the project he is assigned. So he cannot make any effective use of the internet, because the whole state is entire Jammu and Kashmir is denied the access to the effective use of internet. So what is the purpose of this information technology? How best you can use the research opportunities available through internet? So this is the one of the black areas or gray areas where the government should immediately learn respecting the UDHR and see that Kashmiris Kashmiris are not denied internet access, and their students are equally Kashmir's students, Kashmir's research scholars, Kashmir's journalists and media, they also compete on par with the other Indian citizenry, citizen students, research scholars and other things. So this access to internet is a must for the Kashmiris, and this is an occasion for me to see that government restores 4G and 5G, if not 5G, at least 4G internet access to all the Kashmiris. And another thing is, every person should have a nationality according to Article 15 of the UDHR. But sometimes, though theoretically, citizenship and nationality are different, but they are so intertwined that you cannot, in ordinary practice, distinguish between a nationality and a citizenship. But see, every citizen have the nationality, though every nationality, a national may not be a citizen. That is a theoretical principle, but in practice, this distinction is easily erased. So this nationality, one gets, one feels that if he is a citizen of a particular country. But what is happening in India, the recent times, is in the name of Citizenship Amendment Act, you are denying citizenship to some people on the basis of religion, on the basis of religion. This is not the, this is a most dangerous signal to the Indian polity. Because here, religion is not the basis for enjoying the rights enshrined or the contained in the Constitution and other statutes. Religion is not the basis for your existence in this country. When religion is not the basis for your existence or living in this country, when a citizens for citizenship granting also, this should not be a basis. So the only a theocratic state, only a state based on communal theories can say that its citizens are the present citizens, or the people who want to get the citizenship by naturalization, or whatever other modes provided by the Citizenship Act. They get citizenship only on the religion is anathema, referent to the constitutional scheme of secularism. Now, every person has the right to standard of life. Here, This is Article 25 of the UDHR. So this Article 25, it speaks about the minimum standards needed for human existence. So you need to have food, clothing, and shelter, and right to access to medical facilities. So these are the basic things that are needed. But these basic things, though contained in the Article 25 of the UDHR, they do not find place in the fundamental rights in Indian Constitution. Though there are such principles in the directive principles of state policy for your health and nutrition and other things, health and nutrition is not the fundamental right in India. It is the tragedy of the Part 3 of the Constitution. So the essential things required for your very existence, they are relegated to the secondary position and enacted into directive principles of state policy. That is, the state should see that every citizen and every person living in India is healthy and nutritious. So this should be enacted as another fundamental right into our constitution. And another aspect I would like to bring to your notice is, when your fundamental rights are violated by the state, you have the right to remedy. It is Article 8 of the UDHR. Recently, one Mr. Kafil Khan, Dr. Kafil Khan, a Gorakhpur doctor who saved a number of children from dying for want of oxygen, was incarcerated for many days, saying that he criticized the government and he committed other offenses. But ultimately, Allahabad High Court said, no, he did not commit any offense. He is innocent. All the criminal sections imposed upon him are not at all committed. That is, the crimes accused against him were not committed by him. And the court set him at liberty. It is okay. It is a very laudable thing. We have to appreciate it. But at the same time, when his fundamental rights are violated, when his quality life is taken away by the state on unlawful incarceration, is he not entitled for compensation? Legal remedies do not merely mean some release order from the court, but also compensation for the loss suffered by him. But what the Allahabad High Court ought to have done was, it could have awarded compensation on the lines announced by the Supreme Court in Rudul Shah case. Rudul Shah and Bhim Singh, these are the two cases decided by the Supreme Court. When their rights were violated, the government was ordered to pay compensation for their illegal acts. That should be the practice of Indian courts. That is how the Indian courts can say that, yes, we honor the principles enunciated in the UDHR. Let the government give scant respect. But as courts, we can't. That should be the approach of the Indian courts. Let us hope that the Bhim Singh ruling and ruling in Rudul Shah are followed by the courts whenever they are deciding the rights of the people and rights of the innocents who were incarcerated on trumped up charges. So this I took as an opportunity to see how the Indian government is honoring the UDHR provisions by giving a scant respect instead of upholding these rights in letter and spirit, and by showing to the world that the India is ideal state and it honors all the UDHR provisions. And let me say, the understanding of the Human Rights Forum with regard to the rights is this. Violation or denial of rights arises in all situations of structured oppression and inequality. This structured oppression and inequality, wherever you find, are the sources of human rights violations. Caste is a structured oppressive organ, or the upper caste, or the caste which has the access to the administration, which has
I thank Sri G. Madhava Rao Garu for enlightening us and briefing us about Article 5 and the four Varnas, also to mention the IT Act and etc. Now I would like to call upon Miss Karunya to give an introduction about our guest of honor, Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathor, Principal, Nizam College. Karunya, over to you.
Good morning. Am I audible? Actually, I have some connectivity issues.
Yes, Karunya.
Yes, you are audible.
Good morning, everyone. To paraphrase Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathod Garu, Principal of Nizam College, today's guest is associated with Department of Physical Education, Usmania University since 1997. He has organized several national and international conferences and workshops like International Workshop on Recent Trends in Physical Education in June 2016. An international conference on physical education, fitness, sports science in August 2017. He has guided several MPhil and PhD research scholars. Apart from several achievements as sports player, he has vast experience as a coach and team manager. Professor Rathod Garu has more than 70 publications to his credit. He is a member of professional bodies and committees like All India Inter-University Athletic Meet, life member of Sports Psychology Association of India. He was president Telangana Physical Education Teachers Association. He is a member of Academic Senate, Usmania University since 2012. He has visited several countries like China, UK, Thailand, Turkey, France, Vietnam, Iran, Germany, and many more. So please help me in welcoming the exceptionally courageous and skillful person, Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathod Garu. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank IQSC Nizam College and ISTAR for jointly organizing this program. And I welcome today's chief guest, Justice Chandraya Garu, and other keynote speakers, and our IQSC coordinator, Dr. Himabindu Garu, and ISTAR organizers. Regarding this 2 days webinar, I'm congratulating the IQSC members and ISTAR. They are both jointly organizing this webinar. The human rights are moral principles that describe certain standards of human behavior are regularly stated in national and international laws. They are commonly understood in fundamental rights to which found incidentally simple because is human rights, which are inherent in all human beings, regardless in their age, caste, ethics, origin, location, language, religion, ethically or non-other states. The declaration of human rights has been rightly initialed with international laws and global and regional institutions. Actions by states and non-governmental organizations from a basis of public policy worldwide. Ancient people did not have the same modern day concepts of universal human rights. The true human rights discuss about the concept of natural rights, which appeared as part of the medieval natural law tradition that became promoting during European led. From this fundamental modern human rights, argue over the letter, this is the South. Managed to promote social changes over the time of the 20th century in the theme of the human rights. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights is to non-binding declaration adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in 1948, partly in response to behaviors of World War II, the World Human Rights Organization argues member states to promote a member of human, civil, economic, and social rights. Prescribe these rights are part of the foundation of freedom and justice and peace in the world. The declaration was the first international legal efforts to limit the behavior of states and process upon the during to their citizens following model of right day-to-day life. The UN Human Rights Council created in 2005 as a moderate to investigate alleged human rights violations in all over the world. Human Rights Council may request that the Security Council refer to the International Criminal Court, ICC, even in the outside the normal jurisdiction of ICC. You know very well regarding the human rights violations in many states and many countries, the rulers are doing all those things in everywhere. So these 2 days deliberations They are very good keynote speakers. Our organizers are arranged. This will be fruitful for 2 days. I am very much thankful to the organizers once again giving me this opportunity. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much, Professor Lakshmikant Rathore Garu. Your support is extreme, and also without your support, we cannot do all such programs. So thank you for your encouragement, sir. Over to OYSTER team.
My heartfelt thanks to Lakshmikant Rathore Garu, who has enlightened us with some human rights. And now, in nutshell, I would like to pronounce two few lines. Freedom thus implies that individuals have the right to lead their lives as they wish, as long as they respect the equal rights of others. Now, moving on, I would like to announce that if any one of the participants have any queries or doubts regarding any of the topic, please raise your hand or drop your question in chat box.
Actually, today's keynote speaker is in online, but suddenly Wi-Fi is disconnected. So wait for a while time. Sir will join and will give answer to your question. Meanwhile, please post your questions and queries in chat box. Sir will join in soon within 2 minutes. Please wait a while minute. Thank you.
Meanwhile, I'll take this opportunity to brief you all about right to freedom. The Constitution of India contains the right to freedom given in Article 1920, 21A and 22. And with the view of guaranteeing individual rights that were considered vital by the framers of the Constitution. It is a cluster of 4 main laws. The right to freedom in Article 19 guarantees the following 6 freedoms. Freedom of speech and expression, on which the state can impose reasonable restrictions in the interests of the sovereignty and integrity of India, the security of state, friendly relations with foreign states, public order, decency or morality, or in relation to contempt of court, defamation or incitement to an offense. Freedom to assemble peacefully without arms, on which the state can impose reasonable restrictions in the interest of public order and the sovereignty and integrity of India. Freedom to form companies or union or cooperative societies, on which the state can impose reasonable restrictions in the interest of public order, morality and sovereignty and integrity of India. Citizens have the freedom to move freely throughout India, although reasonable restrictions can be imposed on this right in the public's interest, such as to control an epidemic restriction on movement and travel can be imposed. Freedom to reside and settle in any place of the territory of India, subject to reasonable restrictions by the state in the interest of the general public or for the protection of scheduled tribes, because certain safeguards as are envisaged here seem to be justified to protect indigenous and tribal people from exploiting and coercion. Article 370 formally restricted citizens from other Indian states and Kashmiri women who marry men from other states from purchasing land or property in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Article 370 is no longer applicable in the Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh from 6 August 2019. Freedom to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or business. but the state may impose reasonable restrictions in the public interest through statute. Thus, there is no right to carry on a business which is dangerous or immoral. Also, professional or technical qualifications can be precised for practicing any profession or carrying on any trade. Article 20 gives protection in respect of conviction for offences. Court in India has mandated that some of these rights are applicable to non-human entities which have been given the status of a legal person, and humans have the legal duty to act as loco parentis towards animal welfare like a parent has towards the minor children. A deity as a legal person is entitled to the rights. Supreme Court in 2018 enter of human to Saramrimalya guaranteed Lord Ayyappan right to privacy. Rivers are legal persons. Moving on to the right to information, RTI. Right to information has been given the status of a fundamental right under Article 19(1) of the Constitution in 2005. Article 19(1), under which every citizen has freedom of speech and expression and the right to know how the government works, what roles it plays, what its functions are, and so on. Moving on to the right against exploitation. The right against exploitation given in Articles 23 and 24 provides for two provisions, namely the abolition of trafficking in human beings and beggar, and the abolition of employment of children under the age of 14 years in dangerous jobs like factories, mines, etc. Child labor is considered a gross violation of the spirit and provisions of the Constitution. An exception is made in employment without payment for compulsory services for public processes. Compulsory military conscription is covered by this provision. Right to freedom of religion. Right to freedom of religion covered in Articles 25, 26, 28, and 27. Provides religious freedom to all citizens of India. The objective of this right is to sustain the principle of secularism in India. According to the Constitution, all religions are equal before the state and no religion shall be given preference over the other. Citizens are free to preach, practice, and propagate any religion of their choice. But recently we have seen the CAA Act, which implies that they are not treating everyone equal and they are biased on basis of their religion. Here we can raise question and ask whether this right to freedom of religion is implemented correctly. Religious community can set up charitable institutions of their own. However, activities in such institutions that are not religious are performed according to the laws laid down by the government. Now I call upon Arvind to give a vote of thanks. Arvind, over to you.
Hello. Morning to one and all. So, as you know, Deputy Madhura Karu said that he was unable to because of some technical issues. So, as to today, if any of the participants have any questions, can ask to me. Thanks. I deem it a proper vote of thanks to this seminar. First and foremost, and each and every one from the Oyster family, the participants.
I would like to thank each and every person present. Over to Arvind.
Yeah, was there issue from my side or is it from the other side?
Please Hello? Check your connection. Yes, you're audible now.
Yeah, please am I audible? On. Am I visible?
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Everything is okay, please.
Yeah, cool. So yeah, I would like to thank each and everyone from the Oyster family, the honorable guests and the participants for paying attention to this most magnanimous event which we have done it today. I would just like to brief upon the human rights. As you all know, it is necessary and it is for everyone. It is gender neutral and the fluidity of human rights should reach to each and every human being. As it is for human, there is a minimum humanity which we have to show even to the vulnerable people. As we all know, Gurepati Madhav Rao Garu has been saying a story about tribal people. As they are vulnerable and they don't have as much of understanding, but we people should get through it. And the human rights are for everyone. I think that necessity is very important. And I would specially thank each and every guest. Would go with the order, Professor L.B. Lakshmikant Rathod Garu, the Honorable Principal of Nizam College. Our special guest, Sri Jyoti Kalra Garu, Honorable Member of NHRC New Delhi, and Sri Justice G. Chandraya, TSHRC Chairman. Last but not the least, Sri Gurepati Madhavrao Garu, President, TSHRF, Hyderabad. So finally, I would leave you with this inspiring quote by John F. Kennedy. As you all know, he's the 35th President of the United States. He said one quote which really did strike me. The rights of every human is diminished when the rights of even one individual being is diminished. So as you can get through it, that even a single person matters. So human rights is an embodied to fairness, equality, and equity. And thank you for all paying attention. And thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you all for patiently listening from the beginning. Now I'm passing it to Sharatanna.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Varangal. If possible, please on your visa, we can take our photograph for memorial, right? Please take on your visa, if possible, all the parties, if possible only, take a photograph for memorial. Right? Thank you, Varangal. We'll have a tomorrow session, same time, 10:30. Today we are ending somewhat early, but tomorrow we'll have entire session up to 1 o'clock. Who are missing the questions or queries today? Tomorrow we'll discuss. Actually, our guest speakers have some internal issues with the network. Sometimes it happens. So sorry for that inconvenience to the all people. Please on your video. Thank you very much. Thank you. Just on your video, then we'll take one photograph. Thank you. Just wait a minute. Thank you. Thank you, Varanda. Thank you for your patience. Thank you. I will end the meeting. Tomorrow we'll join at the same time. Thank you.